فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
I really hate this notion that which many Muslim speakers and shuyukh and scholars are proud of, which is, well, I don't know anything about politics, I don't speak about politics, I'm not involved in politics, I don't like politics, yeah? But ask me about tahara, salah, financial transactions, etc. I will give you a fatwa, I know about it, but politics, no, 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 keep me away from politics, subhanAllah. And people are proud of it. Ya'ani, they are, or in another word, they are proud of secularism, of being secular. Yes, I don't want to be concerned about the ruling system. Yes, but I am concerned about the personal ibadah, which is secularism, because secularism says, yes, worship Allah, it is between you and your Lord. But if you want to talk about sovereignty, it doesn't belong to Allah. It is not divine. دَعْ مَا لِقَيْسَرْ لِقَيْسَرْ وَدَعْ مَا لِلَّهِ لِلَّهِ. Leave what is for Caesar for him, and leave what is for God for him.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. My beloved brothers and sisters, you all inshallah تعالى have heard what Dr. Haitham al Haddad had said. But before I go into the issue at hand and I tackle the matter, what is very important that I do bi-idhnillahi al-kareem is to give an introduction. The first point that I wanted to mention, inshallah ta'ala, is that it is important that a person understands that clarifying the truth and knowing what is right from wrong, it's a prophetic way. It is why the Qur'an came down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Qur'an, وَكَذَلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ وَلِتَسْتَبِينَ سَبِيلُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. We sent down the Qur'an to explain matters and also to clarify the path of those who have wronged, the path of those who have deviated from the straight path. Now this is not me saying that Dr. Haitham Haddad is a mujrim or the ayah is applying to him. What I mean is that our concept as individuals is that we understand what is right from what is wrong. لذلك Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this Qur'an that we have with us, He called it Al-Furqan. تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده. Furqan. Why is it called Furqan? Because the Qur'an يفرق بين الحق والباطل. It distinguishes, it clarifies the truth from the falsehood. So if my beloved brothers and sisters, we see a wrong taking place and we just become silent about it, why do we become silent? Because we're honoring the person. We are respecting the person. So we just become quiet. And we come with this concept of, well, it's a difference of opinion. And then the truth is not brought out into the light and it's not clarified, then the religion will tarnish. It will become destroyed. This will tarnish the religion. And our religions will turn into the religion of the Christians and the Jews. Because the Christians and Jews, if you look at the Christians today, their religion has become going to the church and dancing and singing. Why? How has it reached that conclusion? How has it reached that point? It reached that point because there was no clarification that were made from those who knew. And they watched the people who were tampering with the religion to tamper with the religion and no one was saying anything. لذلك the Prophet ﷺ said to us, مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرُ بِيَدِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِلِسَانِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. Any one of you who sees munkar, a mistake, a shortcoming, all of that, if you see it, stop it with your hand. If you're not able, then do it with your tongue. And if you're not able to, then hate it in your heart. And that is the weakest of iman. So I think, inshallah ta'ala, intilaqa min hadha al-hadith, me picking up from that hadith, inshallah, trying to implement that hadith, and also the hadith of Abu Ruqayyah ibn Aws al-Dari, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الدين النصيحة قلنا لمن قال لله ولكتابه ولرسوله ولأئمة المسلمين وعامتهم. Now this religion is an advice. And so I hope that I am advising sincerely and that my intentions are clear بإذن الله الكريم. What Dr. Haitham al Haddad said, there are many mistakes in that whole video, but this part that I've cut out, there are a lot of shortcomings on the side of the doctor. Things that he had said that he left unrestricted, things which he had said which is wrong, statements that he used which need ta'qib, which he require to be expanded or clarified. The doctor started by saying, I hate the notion. So he said, I hate. He hates the notion of those du'at and those talabatul ilm who refuse to engage in political laws or political institutions or engage in the political arena. Now, when the doctor says the word politics, as Ibn Khaldun rahimahullah mentions in his muqaddimah, siyasa, he categorized into two. A siyasa which is shara'iyah, which he referred to as khilafah, or is it siyasatul wad'iyah? What do they both mean? Siyasatun shara'iyah, he defined it by calling it, siyasatun shara'iyah, is huwa hamlul kafa ala muqtada al-nazar al-shara'i fi masalihihum al-ukhrawiyyah wal-dunyawiyyah al-raja'atu ilayha. It basically means, it is to cause the masses to act in accordance to the sharia in matters that are beneficial for their worldly and their hereafter affairs. So in other words, the sharia, siyasatun shara'iyah, Islamic politics basically means to carry the general mass, govern them based upon the kitab, ala muqtada al-adillati al-kitab wa sunnah wa ma jara alayhi salafuna salih. Taking the general mass and governing them based on the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and that which the pious predecessors were upon. And also, he categorized it into another, the second type, which is السياسةُ الوضعية. سياسةُ الوضعية, which is man-made political laws, political institution man-made. And he categorized them into two. He called it مُلْكٌ طَبِيعِي and مُلْكٌ سِيَاسِي. مُلْكٌ طَبِيعِي in English translates as natural royal authority. And مُلْكٌ سِيَاسِي translates as political royal authority. And then he defined what both of each mean. مُلْكٌ طَبِيعِي means هو حمل الكافة على عموم هو حمل الكافة عموم الناس على مقتضى الغرض والشهوة. It means to cause the masses to act as required by purpose and desires. Means the hakim and the wali, the governor and the leader, he causes the mass to act in accordance to his own purposes and his own desires. Siyasa, the second type of the siyasatun wad'iyya, which is mulkun siyasi, which is political royal authority, is huwa hamlul kafa ala muqtada al-nazar al-aqli fi jalb al-masalih al-dunyawiyya wa daf' al-madar, which means to cause the masses to act as required by intellectual, rational insight into the means of furthering their worldly interest and avoiding anything that is harmful in that respect. So if you look at the political laws, the two types, which is the siyasatun wad'iyya, he categorized them into two, Ibn al-Khaddur rahimahullah ta'ala. And when he categorized them into two, you can see that they have one thing in common, which is that the siyasa, which is wad'iyya, they both have one thing in common, which is they are both worldly affairs. They only suffice the people in their worldly affairs. But they do not move on to carrying the mass in accordance to the interest that they have of their hereafter affairs. Not at all. So when the doctor says that he hates the notion of the du'at and the talabatul ilm who do not like to participate in the political laws and the political institutions or engage in politics, what politics is the doctor referring to? Is he referring to a siyasatun shar'iyya? Or is he referring to a siyasatun wad'iyya? Whichever of those two that he's referring to, it's very dangerous, my beloved brothers and sisters. It really is. And the reason why it is very dangerous is because our messenger, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Quraysh and he announced the fact that he's a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing that he started with his message is to call the people to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshiping Him alone, and to not associate Him with partners. As Allah said, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَجِتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. To worship Allah alone and not to associate partners with Him. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. That Allah did not send down a messenger before Muhammad. He did not send except that Allah revealed unto them, worship Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala alone and do not associate partners with Him. And our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whilst in the course of his life, or whilst he was conveying this message, alayhi salatu wasalam, Quraysh came to him and they offered him leadership. They offered to put him in charge. They said, if you want leadership, we'll give it to you. And our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rafada dhalika kullu. He refused all of that and rejected it. And the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rejected all of that is because he wanted the tawheed to be solidified. And this is why Allah created mankind. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create jinn or ins except to worship Allah alone. So our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he rejected it and he refused to take it. He refused to take their proposal. Keeping in mind, my beloved brothers and sisters, that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam governing Quraysh, and the siyadat Quraysh, governing Quraysh ta'ni siyadat al-Arab. It meant that he would govern all Arabs. If he accepted that proposal and he became the leader of Quraysh, then that means all Arab will surrender to him. And the Prophet could have then said, this could be a means for me to spread my da'wah and for me to call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Prophet rejected it. There's a hadith in Sirat ibn Hisham, in which Sheikh Nasir al-Din al-Albani authenticated that Utbah ibn Rabi'a, that a yawm in one day, wa huwa jalisun fi nadi Quraysh. Utbah ibn Rabi'a was sitting one day in the assembly and the gathering of Quraysh. Wa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam jalisun, and the Prophet was sitting by himself in the masjid. And Utbah ibn Rabi'a, he said to Quraysh, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, ألا أقوم إلى هذا فأكلمه أمورا لعله يقبل بعضها فنعطيه أيها شاء ويكف عنا. He said, O people of Quraysh, should we not stand up to this individual Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Or should I not stand up to him? And I will speak to him about a matter, he may accept some of it from me. I will give him a proposal and he will let us loose and let us be. فقالوا بلى, they said, of course, go to him. فقام عتبة stood up حتى جلس إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he sat next to the Prophet. And then he said to the Prophet when he came to him, he said, يَبْنَ أَخِي, the son of my brother, trying to get the Prophet's heart and get close to him. He said, إِنَّكَ مِنَّا حَيْثُ عَلِمْتَ مِنَ السَّطَةِ فِي الْعَشِيرَةِ. He said, إِنَّكَ يَبْنَ أَخِي, إِنَّكَ مِنَّا حَيْثُ قَدْ عَلِمْتَ مِنَ السَّطَةِ فِي الْعَشِيرَةِ. Muhammad, you know where you stand to us. وَالْمَكَانَةِ فِي النَّسَبِ, وَالْمَكَانُ فِي النَّسَبِ, and your position in the lineage. You know where you stand and you know what you mean to us. وَإِنَّكَ قَدْ أَتَيْتَ قَوْمَكَ بِأَمْرٍ عَظِيمٍ فَرَّقْتَ بِهِمْ جَمَاعَتَهُمْ. You have come with something very great and something very big. You've divided your disunity. You've caused disunity. And you have broken the people into, you took the slaves away from us. A child and his father. The father is a Muslim or the son is a Muslim and the other one is not. You've divided the people. وَسَفَّهْتَ بِهِمْ أَحْلَامَهُمْ وَعِبْتَ بِهِمْ آلِهَتَهُمْ وَدِينَهُمْ وَكَفَرْتَ مَنْ مَضَى مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ. You have classified them as dimwitted, their religion, and you've insulted them and their religion, and you've labeled their fathers and their forefathers as disbelievers. فاستمع مني محمد, listen to me. أعرض عليك أمورا تنظر فيها. I'm going to present some things to you. Look into it. فقال رسول الله, the messenger said to him, قل يا أبا الوليد, أسمع. Say what you want, I will listen to you. فقال يا ابن أخي, he said, the son of my brother, my nephew. إن كنت إنما تريد بما جئت من هذا القول مالا, جمعنا لك من أموالنا حتى تكون أكثرنا مالا. My nephew, if you are intending with this message that you have come, you're looking for money and that's all you want, then we will gather all of our money to you and we'll make you the richest of us. وَإِن كُنْتَ إِنَّمَا تُرِيدُ شَرَفًا, if you're looking for honor, شَرَّفْنَاكَ عَلَيْنَا, we will make you honorable on us, most honorable one amongst us. If what you're looking for is reputation and dignity and respect, then we'll bring that to you. حَتَّى لَا نَقْطَ أَمْرًا دُونَكَ, we're going to respect you so much and honor you so much that we will not make a decision without your consultation and without your saying. وَإِن كُنْتَ تُرِيدُ مُلْكًا مَلَّكْنَاكَ, and if you're looking for leadership, you're looking to be a king, you want to be in charge, if that is your purpose and that is your goal, then we are here to make you a king. Pay attention if that's your goal. And if you look at what Dr. Haitham al Haddad was saying, is he wants the talabatul ilm and the students of knowledge to engage in politics. And this is a alaqa between the two. Our messenger did not come to compete with them in their worldly affairs. And he did not come for this purpose. He came to spread tawheed. He came to fight against shirk. He came to spread sunnah. And he came to get rid of innovation. Alayhi salatu wassalam. Now that being the case, they are now offering him. They're offering. He's not asking for it. They're saying, here, we're going to give it to you. And he's rejecting it. Why didn't our Prophet say, alayhi salatu wassalam, I will take it? Look what he responded by saying. When he said all of that, he said, أَفَرَغْتِ أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, have you finished what you were saying? قَالَ نَعَمْ, he said, I finished what I wanted to say. قَالَ فَاسْتَمِعْ مِنِّي, listen to me. Listen to what I have to tell you. قَالَ أَفْعَلُ, he said, I'm going to do that. I'll listen to you. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, حَامِيم, تَنْزِيلٌ مِّنَ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ, كِتَابٌ فُصِّلَتْ آيَاتُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ. Until he got to the ayah, فَإِنْ أَعْرَضُوا فَقُلْ أَنْظَرْتُكُمْ صَاعِقَةً مِثْلَ صَاعِقَةِ عَادٍ وَثَمُودَ. When the Prophet ﷺ said that, he said to him, قَدْ سَمِعْتَ يَا أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, you heard, مَا سَمِعْتَ, that which you heard, فَأَنْتَ وَذَاكَ, there you are. There you are, I've said what I wanted to say to you. So our messenger responded to him by just reciting those verses to him. Rather, my brothers and sisters who are listening, our messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, the harm of Quraysh, it increased even more onto him. And they caused harm on his da'wah. And they caused him headache, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he's only calling them to what? Ibadatullahi wahda, to worship Allah alone. Do not associate partners with him. He still did not take leadership, did not run after positions. Because we Muslims here in the West are saying, we're suffering. We're going through a lot of hardship. So then why? Then we need to engage in these political laws, these constitutions. We have to have an MP who represents us. If we don't have a say in the cabinet ministers, if we don't have a say, we're going to be crushed. We're gonna suffer our universities, our educations. Our Prophet suffered. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And look what he did. Instead of saying, Ya Quraysh, I want a representative in your assemblies and your gatherings. He didn't say that, alayhi salatu wasalam. Rather, he told his Sahabis to do hijrah. He said, travel and leave this land. Go to Abyssinia. Go there. Because there is a leader who is just, a king that is just. Stay with him. In the meantime, what was he doing? The Prophet ﷺ was going in the Mawasim. He was going to Uqaba. He was going to Majannah. All of those places. One place to another. And he was asking the people, Man yu'wini, who's going to give me shelter? Man yansuruni, who's going to give me victory? For what reason? So I can be a leader? So I can be the prime minister, the president, the khalif? No. Hatta ubelligha risalati rabbi, so I can convey the message of my Lord. Walahu al-jannah, and Allah is going to give him jannah. Fala yajidu ahadan yansuruhu wa yu'wi. The Prophet could not find anyone giving victory and anyone giving him support and aid. Dr. Haitham al-Haddad, in his, he wants the dua, the talabatul ilm, to occupy their time in calling to the tawheed, calling to the religion of Allah. He wants them to occupy their time with participating in political elections, participating in these in these matters. Rather, our concept is al-khilafa thamara min thamarati tawheed. Khilafa is a fruit. It's an outcome after tawheed has been established. Once tawheed has been established on the land and shirk has been fought, then and only then can a khilafa occur. وَلِذَلِكَ the khilafa Allah attributed it to himself. In other words, the khilafa is a minhatun rabbaniyah and is a hibatun ilahiyah. The khilafa is something Allah, he gifts. It is something he bestows upon who he wishes. But he has placed conditions. Let's find if these conditions are part of it. Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, if you engage in political issues or you engage yourself in these the political arena, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take you out of your hardship and Allah will make you khulafa on the earth? Is that what Allah said? Rather no. What Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said to us is, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, that was in Surah An-Nur, ayah 55. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Surah Al-Hajj, ayah 40 to ayah 41. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-Fath, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. Allah also said, says that Surah Al-Fath, ayah 28. Allah also says in Surah Al-Nahl, ayah 62, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضَّرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ. I now want you to all focus on these verses with me. In the first verse, I brought Surah An-Nur, ayah 55. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ. Allah is going to make them governors on this earth. In the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ. The ones who we make them governors on this earth. In the ayah after that, the other ayah in Surah Al-Fath, Allah says, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى دِينِ, that Allah makes them apparent on this earth. In the ayah in Surah Al-Nahl, ayah Al-Naml, Surah ayah 62, Allah says, وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ. Allah makes you governors on this earth. So we have لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ. We have مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. We have لِيُظْهِرَهُ. We have وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ. Who has Allah attributed to the one making the people khulafa? Who makes us leaders? Who makes us reach khilafa? Whose hands is it in? It's in the hands of Allah. What conditions did Allah stipulate? These are conditions that Allah stipulated for us to gain khilafa. It is not that we engage in political in the political arena. Look what Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the answer that Allah gave, which is what? يَعْبُدُونَنِي يُوَشْرِكُ مِي أَلَّوْنَ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. And you do not associate partners with me. That's the condition that was stipulated on the Surah An-Nur, ayah 55. In Surah Al-Hajj, ayah 40 to 41, Allah says what? وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ. Allah is going to give victory to you when you give victory to his religion. Then Allah goes on to say, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, the ones who we make them solidified on this earth, we make them governors of this earth, are people who have what? أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ, they established a prayer. وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ, they give the zakat. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and they call to the good. وَنَهُ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and they prohibit the evil. So, for Allah to make us governors on this earth, prayer has to be present in us. Zakat has to be paid. Calling to the good and prohibiting the evil has to be a characteristic of ours. Not to engage in political arena. That's not what Allah told us. Also, Allah said in the ayah, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. Allah sent down two things in this ayah. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ, Allah sent with his messenger. بِالْهُدَى, guidance. وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, and the religion of truth. What's the guidance, my beloved brothers and sisters? It is العلم النافع, beneficial knowledge. وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ, عَمَلُ الصَّالِحِ, righteous actions. So beneficial knowledge and righteous actions, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. When we come with beneficial knowledge and righteous actions, Allah will make us apparent on this earth. Allah will make us be seen on this earth. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضَّرَّ إِذَا دَعَى. Who is the one who lifts suffering from us when we call on to him? ikhlas, in tawheed, that we are only going to ask him. We're not going to associate partners with him. When we do that, what will Allah do? وَيَجْعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ Allah will make you governors on this earth. الشيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي رحمه الله, he says, لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ Surah An-Nur, ayah 55, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when in that ayah, he says, وَالْآيَاتُ تَدُلُّ These verses indicate, عَلَىٰ أَنَّ طَاعَةَ اللَّهِ Obeying Allah, بِالْإِيمَانِ بِهِ By believing in Him, وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحَ And come with righteous actions, سَبَبٌ لِلْقُوَّةِ It is the way to gain strength. وَالْإِسْتِخْلَافِ فِي الْأَرْضِ To be governors on this earth. وَنُفُوذِ الْكَلِمَةِ And that our words are taken serious. And it's executed and it's done. Shaykh al-Albani said a kalam yastahiqu an yuktaba bima'i dhahab. Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah said a statement that deserves to be written in ink of gold. Shaykh al-Albani says, هَؤُلَاءِ الدُّعَاتِ These individuals who are calling to the path of Allah, الَّذِينَ يُرِيدُونَ الْوُصُولَ إِلَىٰ تَحْقِيقِ غَايَةِ الْعُظْمَى Who want to reach this ultimate goal, which is what? وَهِيَ إِقَامَةُ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ To establish the law of Allah on this earth. وَإِيجَادُ الْخِلَافَةِ And to bring khilafah into place. الراشدة بعد تلك الخلافة الماضية After the khilafah went, they want to bring back the noble khilafah again. التي يتفق جميع المسلمين على وجوب تحقيقها Which every Muslim unanimously agree that bringing it back is something that is needed and it's obligatory. We all agree. But what do we differ on? ولكنهم يختلفون في الوسيلة We differ in the way to bring back the khilafah. وفي الطريق and in the manner that we should bring back khilafah. Dr. Haitham al Haddad is saying the way we can and the way he wants us to do it. Because if we don't do it, the doctor is angry. He doesn't like it. He said, I hate this notion. Is what? To engage in politics. We differ with that. We believe that's not the case. The ayat of the Quran is not on him, with him on this regard. The ayat of the Quran is clearly telling us something different. And Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani, who's older in age than Dr. Haitham al Haddad, وَأَعْلَمُ مِنْهُ And more knowledgeable than him, الشيخ الباني رحمه الله at the age of 20 was the first book he wrote اتخاذ الساجد that was the first book he wrote he was 20 and الشيخ الباني died at the age of 83 63 years of his life he was serving the religion 63 years he was خدمة he was serving the science of hadith so it's, a lot of us who are watching here some of our parents are not 63 some of our parents are not 63 the Sheikh died at the age of 64 63 And he's talking with experience and knowledge. And inshallah ta'ala, other scholars I'm going to quote, bidhinillahi al-kareem. He said, وَلَكِنَّهُمْ But what we differ with them is الوسيلة in the way and in the path to gain it. وَنَحْنُ سَلَفِيُّونَ مَعَهُمْ فِي هَذِي الْغَايَةِ We're with them in the goal. لَكِنَّنَا لَسْنَا مَعَهُمْ فِي الْوَسِيلَةِ But we're not with him, in the way he wants to approach this matter. نَحْنُ وَسِيلَتُنَا Our manner and our means is أنه لا بد من العلم النافع والعمل الصالح. It has to be with righteous, beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. My beloved brothers and sisters, where did Albani get that from? He got it from the ayah هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. The Sheikh is talking from منبع الوحي. He's talking from the source of the revelation. You see, so our means to gain خلافة is beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. والعلم النافع. What is the beneficial knowledge? هو ما كان مبنيا على كتاب الله وحديث رسول الله. It is that which is built upon the book of Allah and the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحديث الصحيح فقط. The Sheikh says the only hadith he's referring to is the authentic hadith. وعلى فهم سلف الصالح and based on the understanding of the pious predecessors. والعمل بهذا العلم and the implementation of that knowledge. The knowledge of the kitab. The knowledge of the sunnah and the knowledge of how the sahabas understood implementing that. وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ الْيَوْمَ The Sheikh says, if the Muslims all come together, جَمِيعًا all of them, عَلَى الْعِلْمِ النَّافِعِ on beneficial knowledge, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَعْمَلُوا بِذَلِكَ but they don't implement that knowledge, فَلَمْ يَصِرُوا إِلَى هَدَفِهِمُ الْمَنْشُودِ They are not going to gain the ultimate goal which they are looking for. وَهِيَ إِقَامَةُ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ which is to establish the law of Allah on this earth. ذَلِكَ the reason is because لِأَنَّ فَاقِدُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْطِيهِ Because one who doesn't have cannot give. فَنَحْنُ we مَعَ كُلِّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى حُكْمِ إِلَى إِقَامَةِ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ فِي الْأَرْضِ We are with every single person who is saying establish the law of Allah on this earth. We are with them. وَتَحْقِيقِ مَا يُسَمُّونَهُ الْيَوْمَ الْحَاكِمِيَةِ لِلَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ And the Sheikh said, as it today is referred to as حَاكِمِيَة for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala not to associate partners with Allah in the law, we're with them on this. We want the hukum of Allah on this earth. We want only Allah's law to be judged. That we're with them on it. وَلَكِنَّنَا بَتْ نَخْتَلِفُ عَنْهُمْ كُلَّ الْإِخْتِلَافِ فِي الطَّرِيقِ. But we differ with them in all of the word ikhtilaf, what it means, we differ fully, 100% in the path that is taken. The reason is طَرِيقُنَا طَوِيلٌ وَمَدِيدٌ. Many people don't like our path. The reason why they don't like it is because it is a long path. It's very long. You don't see the results quickly. طَرِيقٌ طَوِيلٌ مَدِيدٌ وَطَرِيقُهُمْ. Sheikh Albani says their path is قَصِيرٌ, it's very short. وَلَكِنَّهُ مُنْحَرِفٌ. But it's a deviated path. وَلَكِنَّهُ مُنْحَرِفٌ عَنِ الصَّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. But their path is short, but it's deviated. It's quick, shortcuts. وَذَلِكَ, and then the Sheikh says, that وَذَلِكَ مَا أَشَارَ إِلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي هَذِهِ الصُّورَةِ الْجَمِيلَةِ الْبَدِيعَةِ حِينَمَا خَطَّ الصِّرَاطِ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ خَطًّا طَوِيلًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. And then the Sheikh connected this to when the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, which the Prophet ﷺ made a path on the road. The road that he made, which was the Sirat al-Mustaqim, was it long? Yes. The Sirat al-Mustaqim was the longest one. And the other paths were shorter and they were little. You see? And they were more than it. So the Sheikh said that this is the example that refers to it. And why is the case? Is because shaitan is on those paths, calling the people to it. So the kalam of the Shaykh rahimahullah, you can find it in his talk, Al-Wuhdat wal-Ittifaq, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Now, my beloved brothers and sisters who are listening, there's something I have to mention, which is, where did this concept come to Dr. Haitham al Haddad from? Where did he bring this idea and this mindset of pushing the du'at and gauging them into politics? Iqhamu du'at, pushing the du'at to taking part in the political arena. Where does this idea come from? Before I mention that, from the angle of amanatul ilmiya, from the angle of being fair and honest in the way I transmit the information, is that there are some scholars, and I'm going to expand on that more later inshallah ta'ala, which is, there are some scholars, because Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Baz, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, rather Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, his kalam, you can even realize from it that it's wajib to participate in these political issues. You have to. It's wajib. And the reason why those scholars said it and that which Dr. Haitham al-Haddad is on is two different things. I have to explain this. Because I hear a lot of people say, well, if you took the statement of Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani, then we have taken the view of Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Baz and the view of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. So now let me explain this to you. Al-Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah and Al-Sheikh Abdulaziz ibn Baz, who are two noble imams, scholars, when they said that engaging in these political arena, what were they talking about? They were coming from the angle of, this issue is مِنْ بَابِ دَرْءِ الْمَفَاسِدِ, it is to repel the evil. In other words, the Muslims, ضَرُورَ and necessity has forced them to engage in this. It's obligatory. مِنْ بَابِ ضَرُورَ. Dr. Haitham al-Haddad, like, no. Dr. Haitham is coming from the angle of that it is what? مِنْ بَابِ أَنَّهُ وَسِيلَةِ. That engaging in the political arena is a means, that it's not the minbab al-darura, and it is a wasila. That the du'at, it's a means that the du'at have to take, meaning, in other words, they have to make it part of their da'wah. And it is a portion of, because look at him, the doctor here right now saying, I hate those who, or the notion that says, that I don't want to participate in politics. The Sheikh wants participation. Make it part of our da'wah, that we have to be part of it. And that's what he's engaging. So it's important that we distinguish between the two. Because the mafsada, the mafasid and the masalih, is matter which is, that it, in its asal, it wasn't allowed. But it got permitted because of a necessity that came. But when it becomes a wasila and a means, then it's a whole different situation. So, my beloved brothers and sisters, this concept of making the da'wat amalu siyasi, this political engagement, ليس طريقة أهل السنة والجماعة. والله is not the path of أهل السنة والجماعة. لا من قريب ولا من بعيد. And rather, it is the path of these تيارات والأحزاب الإسلامية المخالفة للسنة. These groups and these ideologies and sects who are in opposition to the Kitab and the Sunnah. Because they are the ones who see it as what? فهم يرونه دينا وقربة. They see it as a way to get closer to Allah by doing this. I mean, it's part of their religion. ويسلكون أساسا على أساس أنه وسيلة المشروعة. They actually see it that this is a means that's legislated for them. Well, and that was not the fatwa of Sheikh Ibn Baz and the fatwa of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. And inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to expand on it later. But the question that one needs to ask himself is, so where did this come from? Where has this ideology creeped into us from? That the doctor here is saying that he hates the notion of those who are not participating in politics. Where did this notion come from? The first person, my beloved brothers and sisters, who made the du'at, the people who are in the arena of da'wah, who are calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and politics that I'm referring to here is the siyasatun wad'iyya. I'm not referring to siyasatun shara'iyya, because we don't have siyasatun shara'iyya right now. We have no khilafah to talk about. We're looking at England, which is a democratical country, and we're looking at other countries, which are all qawaneen al-wad'iyya. Who was the first person who engaged and placed, okay, the du'at into entering into the arena of siyasa, politics? The first individual is a man by the name of Jamaluddin al-Afghani. He was the first person who had pushed this idea. And as one would know, is that أنه لم يكن من أهل السنة والجماعة. Jamaluddin al-Afghani was not from the people of the Sunnah. He was not from أهل السنة والجماعة. أساسا فلم يكن على الجادة. He was not upon the path of أهل السنة. He was a person who was deviated. And he was the first person who actually started it. Jamaluddin al-Afghani died in the year 1896. And of course, when an idea starts and it's pushed, then of course it moves on to those you teach. And so Jamaluddin al-Afghani had affected, or his approach had an effect on his student Muhammad Abduh, who then took it on. Muhammad Abduh, who died the year 1905, was very affected. تأثر بجمالدين الأفغاني. Was truly affected by جمالدين الأفغاني. And because of that, وأنشأ مجلة. He created a magazine which he called it العروة الوثقى. He called it العروة الوثقى. In which he spoke about politics, and that which he saw about politics, and he spoke about حكومات, governments, and what was wrong, and how things need to be changed, and etc. Muhammad Abduh, he passed that message over just the same way it was passed over to him by Jamaluddin al-Afghani. He passed it over to his student, Muhammad Rashid Rida. And Muhammad Rashid Rida, rahimahullah ta'ala, was different from Muhammad Abduh and was different from Jamaluddin al-Afghani. The difference between them and him was that Muhammad Rashid Rida, في الجملة, in totality, in conclusion, was a man from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, was a man of the Sunnah. تبنى له تبنى على عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة. تبنى دعوة إلى التوحيد. He was a man who took on the path of calling to the path of Allah سبحانه وتعالى ونبذ الشرك, fighting with associating partners with Allah. So this was it. But the problem is, بقيت عنده بقايا. It remained with him the effects of his teacher Muhammad Abduh. But my beloved brothers and sisters, this is a point that I want to draw home, and I want every single one who's listening to me to listen to this. And this is, my beloved brothers and sisters, this history that I'm telling you, and this is very important, is because you realize where all of this stems from and where it came from. And that when we speak about these issues, it's not like it's the first time we're hearing it. And it's not. And when you read and you study, then you realize that the same statements are being repeated again and again and again. Muhammad Abduh, who spent all of his life under the what? Under the shade of politics. في ظل السياسة. And was a person who got du'at. أقحم الدعات. He took the du'at from the and pushed them into politics. at his last moments of his life, he came to ala niqma azima. He regretted it, the word regret. And this is what he said. I'm going to read his statement on you. And please, my beloved brothers and sisters, listen to this. Look what he said. He said, أعوذ بالله من السياسة ومن لفظ السياسة ومن معنى السياسة ومن كل حرف يلفظ من كلمة السياسة ومن كل خيال يخطر في بالي من السياسة ومن كل أرض تذكر فيها السياسة ومن كل شيخ يتكلم أو يتعلم السياسة أو يحب أو يعقل في السياسة ومن ساس ويسوس وسائس ومسوس. So محمد عبدو بعد تجربة مريرة في العمل السياسي, he came with this what? على نقمة عظيمة. He really regretted it. To the extent that he said, أعوذ بالله, I seek refuge in Allah من السياسة, from politics. ومن لفظ السياسة and the word سياسة. ومن معنى السياسة and the meaning of سياسة. ومن كل حرف and every letter that is mentioned from the word سياسة. And ومن كل خيال يخطر في بالي من السياسة. And every thought that comes to my mind pertaining to politics. ومن كل أرض تذكر فيها السياسة. And every land in which politics is mentioned. ومن كل شيخ يتكلم أو يتعلم السياسة. Or every شيخ who speaks or who learns politics, I seek refuge in Allah from him. Or yuhibbu, or he loves, an ya'qila fi siyasa, who wants to understand and ponder on politics, I seek refuge in Allah from it. Wa min sasa, wa yasusu, wa sa'isin, wa masusin. And these are the ishtiqaqat, the root words of the word siyasa. All of that, I seek refuge in Allah from it. So my beloved brothers, what does that show you? Hada yadullu ala niqma shadida. This shows he regretted it. He regretted in dealing and being part of politics. And he said this, my beloved brothers and sisters, as I said, بعد تجربة طويلة في العمل السياسي. He said this after years of his life. Now, Dr. Haitham, what is it that you know that Muhammad Abdul doesn't know? What is it that you've come to understand? Are we going to fall into the same hole again? And every time get bit from the same hole, المؤمن لا يدلغ المؤمن من جحر واحد مرتين. A believer is not bit from the same hole twice. Muhammad Rashid Rida, who is the student of Muhammad Abdul, he didn't really agree with his teacher fully. He didn't fully agree with his teacher. And he carried on participating and taking place in da'wah. But of course, he carried on calling to the sunnah and calling to aqidah and fighting against shirk. This is something that he did, Muhammad Rashid Rida. And Muhammad Rashid Rida, kawwana awwala hizb siyasi, he was the first person who actually made a political movement. He was the first. When I say Hizbun Siyasi, meaning I'm talking about Hizb Islami, a Islamic political movement. He was the first to make it. And he did this in Egypt. And he called it Hizbul Ittihad Ashuri. And one of the harms and the effects that Muhammad Rashid Rida fell into, and politics in general throws a da'i into, which is تذيب الفوارق بين السنة والبدعة بعد مضي الزمن. After time, what politics does to you, this evil politics does to you, is that the line between the sunnah and the bid'ah become blurry. The sunnah and the bid'ah all become one. And Muhammad Rashid Rida started to implement this qa'ida, which is نتعاونوا على ما نتفق عليه ويعذر بعضنا بعضا فيما نختلف فيه. We will work with one another in what we agree upon, and we will excuse one another in that which we differ on. And he started to inherit that concept. To the extent, he started to try to bring the Shia and the Sunnah together. And one of the statements that he said, Rahimahullah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him, was that, يَنْبَغِي أَن نَتْرُكَ الْخِلَافَاتِ جَانِبًا. We should leave our differences aside, referring to the Shia and the Sunnah. We should put our differences aside. And do what? وأن نتعاون على أمر يقود إلى حكم الإسلامي عامة. And we should work towards a matter that will bring Islam back to its khilaf and its leadership again. You see? So this is the problem what siyasa does to you. Because in siyasa, my beloved brothers and sisters, you can't have thawabit. You can't have things that you're solidified on. Politics is about being beaten behind the bushes. You can't be direct and you can't be straight up. You see? Walakin Muhammad Rashid Rida, after many years of his life spending in politics, ma hasala shay'an, he did not benefit anything from it, wa adaa juhdan kabiran min waqti, and he wasted a lot of his time. But even that though, alayhi rahmatullah, he also was working on the issue of tathiru aqaid al-muslimin. he was working on purifying the people's aqidah and al-inayatu bil ilmi wa ta'lim, calling the people to knowledge and guiding them to the religion of Allah according to the madhab of Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And he used to have the majalla called Majallatul Manar, which he, rahimahullah ta'ala, did benefit the ummah through that majalla. And Sheikh al-Albani was affected by it, and that's what made Sheikh al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, take on board to become a person of hadith. After this point, Ikhwanul Muslimin, they took on this. So this is where Ikhwanul Muslimin came into a place. After Muhammad Rashid Rida, Jama'at Ikhwanul Muslimin, they came. But the difference between Ikhwanul Muslimin and that which was before it is that Ikhwanul Muslimin, they made the politics juz'an asasiyan min aqidatim wa madhhabim. They made the siyasa a part of their aqidah and their madhhab. الذي لا يقوم على كتاب ولا على سنة ولا على اتباع سلفنا الصالح. They did not base on the kitab nor the sunnah and not to following the pious predecessors. They fully based their whole belief on politics. Everywhere politics, any speech you have, politics. Are you with me? And da'wah siyasa became darajat al-ula, the first concern, the first thing to tackle, the first thing that needs to be done. And of course, after them, Hizb al-Tahrir was affected by the mindset of Hizb Ikhwan al-Muslimin, and they took it on board. So what do we learn from this, my beloved brothers and sisters? That this concept of politics, emerging it into da'wah, was something that was inherited from these individuals. لم يؤخذ من طريق السلف. It was not taken from the salaf. ولا من طريق الأئمة. And it was not taken from the أئمة السنة. ورادَ إنما منشأ المشاركة السياسية ومنشأ إقحام العمل السياسي في مجالات الدعوة مأخوذ من أفكار جديدة. It was taken from these newly introduced groups and these newly introduced individuals who were recent. You see, and Ikhwan al-Muslimin, as you would all know, they are two types. Mainly they are two types. There's a Shiqq al-Bannawi and there's the Shiqq which are the Sururi and the Qutbi. The Bannawi are the ones who are Hassan al-Banna. Their mindset is different. They believe the way to engage in politics is what? Majalis al-Niyabiyya. You know, let's be member of parliament. Let's be part of the elections. Let's be in the system. If you can't beat them, join them. Whereas the Sururi and the Qutbi, their da'wah is al-muwajaha wa takfir al-hukam. They do takfir of the leaders and they're more. At this particular point, when Hizb al-Tahrir and Ikhwan al-Muslimin came, Salafis were outside the arena of all of this. And alhamdulillah, were always clear on their stances regarding politics and da'wah. And they were concerned more in at-tasfiyah wa at-tarbiyah, which Sheikh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala had spoke about and had taken it from the Nasus al-Shar'iyyah. But Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq, who was a Kuwaiti national, who studied in the University of Medina, who was looked at as a person who came from Medina University, he learned from the Mashayikh who were Ahlul Sunnah at that time, the scholars of the Sunnah he met at that time. So at this point, he had some effect on some of the Salafis and convinced them to participate in political da'wah and etc. And he forced them to go in, and it caused a lot of problem in Kuwait. Its effects were seen, the problem that came from it was seen. Only Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala knows. Now, brothers and sisters, I'm going to come back to the issue before that I slightly touched on, which is the issue of حكم المشاركة السياسية في مجالس النيابية, which is participating in this political arena, taking place in this, being a cabinet minister, a parliament, MP, and etc. We know, as I said before, that the ulama al-mu'asirun, al-Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, al-Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, that they both permitted it. Rather, as I said, Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, from his kalam, you can kind of sense that he was trying to push it, that it's obligatory to go in because of that, because of the lesser of two harms. Min babi daf' al-mafsada, to repel the evil. Are you with me? And from the angle of Allah yutrak al-majal li ahli al-fasad, that we shouldn't leave the arena for the ignorant people to cause harm to the da'wah, for them to sit in an MP, a parliament, and then because of them, laws are passed on to the Muslims and it causes them harm. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he pushed that the Muslims have to participate. But what I said before was that this is from the angle of babu daf'i al-mafsada, not from the bab of what? La min babi annahu wasila. Not from the angle that the du'at, who are, their job is to call the people to tawheed and fight against shirk, call the people to sunnah and fight against innovation, they should not make it juz'an min waqtihim. They should not make it a portion of their time. Tubdalu fihi al-amwal, wealth is spent in it, time is spent on it. This is not what it was. Now, the scholars who permitted it is Sheikh Abdulaziz bin Baz and Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih Uthaymeen. And we have other scholars who did not permit it. From those scholars being Sheikh Muhammad bin Salih, Muhammad bin Nasir al-Din al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala. From those scholars who also didn't permit it, is Ibn Ubadis, rahimahullah, al-Bashir al-Ibrahimi. Also from those who did not permit it was Muhammad Hamid al-Fiqi, wa Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab al-Banna, and also Abdurrahman al-Wakil, rahimahumullahu jami'an. Now that we have those who permit it, which are the mujizin, the mubih, and we have the mani'un, those who are not allowing it and are against it, how do we do tarjih between the two? The strongest view is the ones who say it's not permissible to participate. For two reasons. There are two reasons why they are correct. First of all, they have the textual evidences on their side. دلالات عامة من نصوص وسلف. They have general texts from the Kitab and the Sunnah and also from the practices of the Salaf al-Salih. التي تدل that which indicates على أنهم تركوا هذا الأمر ولم يسلكوه. That the Salaf did not take this path and they turned away from it. The second thing is bina'an 'ala al-waqi'. The reality that we're living in today shows that the statement of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and Sheikh Ibn Baz, which is going into politics to lessen the evil, rather by going into it, a greater evil occurs from it. There's a greater evil that the du'at and those who went into it have actually suffered from. And this is stronger on the side of those who said it's not permissible. Because first of all, they have the textual evidences from the Kitab and the Sunnah and the implementation of the Salaf al-Salih. Where is the implementation? Where is the Kitab and the Sunnah? The Kitab and the Sunnah is the statement of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, where he said, وَمَنْ طَرَقَ بَابُ السُّلْطَانِ افْتُتِنَا. Anyone who knocks on the door of the leader is tested. Are you with me? Anyone who knocks on the door of the leader is tested. This hadith is general. It is am. This is what it is. It's general. And this refers to anyone who goes into the gatherings of the leaders, who participate in these issues, he is going to be tested. And inshallah ta'ala later, I'm going to show the examples of that. Bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. And also the Salaf. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, يقول المهنى said that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was asked about Ibrahim al-Harawi. Ibn al-Muhanna himself, some of the riwayat he says, Sa'altu Imam Ahmad, I asked Imam Ahmad myself, and Ibrahim ibn al-Harawi, I asked him about him. And then Imam Ahmad said, Rajulun wasikh, he's a filthy man. Faqultu, I said, Ma qawluk innahu rajulun wasikh. Why have you said that he's a filthy man? Imam Ahmad said, Man yattabi'u al-wulata wal-qudata fa'inu wasikh. Anyone who follows the leaders and those in charge is a filthy person. Are you with me? If you look at the statement of Tawus ibn Kaysan, if you look at Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, al-A'raj, al-Thawri, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and others, min a'imati al-ilm wa salaf al-salih, lam yukhalitu al-muluk. They stayed away from the leaders. Wajtanabu dhalika. And they stayed away as far as they could from the angle of what? Man taraka bab al-sultan iftutin. Anyone who knocks on the door of the leader is tested. And those who did go to the leaders, and those who did sit with the leaders, like Ibn Abi Layla, when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, they went in there individually. They went there on the basis of individual and they came out. They went, sat with them from the angle of al-Nasiha and to go. Like, to say that the Muslims have to engage in politics, they have to be part of the political arena, this is actually telling them to mix in. And this goes against the prophetic sunnah, alayhi salatu wasalam. Also, the other second evidences that these scholars have based upon is the tajruba, the reality. which I'm going to touch on inshallah ta'ala. Sheikh Al-Albani has a very long statement of his, which he speaks to the people, and he tells them what he believes. But he said something which I believe should be said. He said, فَلِشْتِغَالُ بِالْعَمَلِ السِّيَاسِي, engaging in politics, قَبْلَ أَن تَصِلَ الْأُمَّةَ وَالْجَمَاعَةِ إِلَى مَرْحَلَةِ, before the ummah have reached a level where the علم النافع and عمل الصالح has gone to a good point, ستكون عقيبة أن تنهار الدعوة. If we don't do that and we just go fast into politics, like Sheikh Dr. Haitham al Haddad is saying to طلبة العلم and the du'at, he's telling them participate in politics, be part of it. تنهار الدعوة, the da'wah is going to be destroyed like that. وأن ترجع القهقراء, and every effort that we're done is going to go back. ورب أناس لا يقتنعون بهذه النظرية من ناحية العلمية. The Sheikh said, but some people are not going to be pleased with this concept of his. رحمه الله تعالى. He's not the only one who said that. He's not the only one who said that. Let's listen to the Ibn Badis, رحمه الله, and Al-Bashir al-Ibrahimi. Bashir al-Ibrahimi and Ibn Badis are from the ulama of Jazair. And they had a jam'iyya called Jam'iyya Ulama'i al-Muslimin. They lived to see these parliaments and these matters. They saw it. You with me? They saw it with their own eyes. Different to Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and Sheikh Ibn Baz. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and Sheikh Ibn Baz, their government is different. These individuals, these ulama, they saw colonies. They saw political elections. They saw the it was affecting the Muslims. So did Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. And this is what he said, Ibn Badiz. He said, اتقوا الله ورحموا عباد الله. Fear Allah and have mercy upon the slaves of Allah. اخدموا العلم. Serve knowledge. بتعليمه, by teaching it, ونشري, and by spreading it. تحملوا كل بلاء ومشقة في سبيله. Endure every hardship and pain that comes in this path. And he went on to saying. And he also said, وَأَمَّا الْأُمُورُ الْحُكُومِيَةِ, as for matters pertaining to governmental matters and politics, وَمَا يُتَوَصَّلُ بِهَا فَدَعُوهَا لِأَهْلِهَا, leave it for its people. وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَأَنْ تَتَعَرَّضُوا لَهَا بِشَيْءٍ, and stay away from going into it. وَلَوْ أَرَدْنَا أَن نَدْخُلَ الْمَيْدَانَ السِّيَاسِي, Ibn Badi saying, if we wanted to enter the field of politics, لَدَخَلْنَاهُ جَهْرًا, we would have entered it loud, everybody would have known. وَلَضَرَبْنَا فِي الْمَثَلِ, and we would have given the best example in that arena. Would have done something big. He also mentions when he visited Madinat Umm al-Bawaqi, rahimahullah, he said, قَدْ رَأَيْتُ فِي عِدَّةُ الْبُلْدَانِ سُوءَ أَثَرِ انْتِقَابَاتِ بِالْفُرْقَةِ الَّتِي تَرَكَتْهَا بَيْنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَلَكِنْ أَقْبَحُ مَنْظَرٍ رَأَيْتُهُ مِنْهَا هُوَ مَنْظَرُ هَاتِهِ الْبَلْدَةِ فَهِيَ عَلَى حِزْبَيْنِ مُتَعَادِيَيْنِ مُتَقَاطِعَيْنِ وَقَدْ اشْتَمَلَتْ هَذِهِ الْفُرْقَةُ طَلَبَةُ الْعِلْمِ الَّذِينَ يُنْتَظَرُ مِنْهُمْ إِزَالَتُهَا فَكَانُوا مِنْ صَلَاتِهَا. Ibn Badis, rahimahullah, he visited Ibn al-Bawaqi. And when he visited it, he said, he saw things, but one of the things that he mentions that he saw was the evil effects that elections had in that place, how it divided the Muslims, the evil outcome that came out from it, and that the Muslims were divided into groups. And look what he said after that. وَقَدْ اشْتَمَلَتْ هَذِهِ الْفُرْقَةِ, and this division, it affected the students of knowledge. الَّذِينَ يُنْتَظَرُ مِنْهُمْ إِزَالَتُهَا, those who are awaited to remove it and to repel it. فَكَانُوا مِنْ صَلَاتِهَا, they were the ones who got caught up in it. His friend, وَرَفِيقُ دَرْبِهِ, Ibrahim al-Bashir al-Ibrahimi, he also said the same. And he mentions that, أُوصِيكُمْ بِالْإِبْتِعَادِ عَنْ هَذِي الْحِزْبِيَاتِ, stay away from these political groups, stay away from them. الَّتِي نَجَمَ بِشَرِّ نَاجِمُهَا وَهَجَمَ لِيَفْتِكَ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالْعِلْمِ هَاجِمُهَا وَسَجَمَ عَلَى الْوَطَنِ بِالْمِلْحِ الْأُجَاجِ سَاجِمُهَا إِنَّ هَذِي الْأَحْزَابِ كَالْمِيزَابِ جَمَعَ الْمَاءَ كَدَرًا وَفَرَّقَهُ هَدَرًا فَلَا الزُّلَالُ جَمَعَ وَلَا الْأَرْضِ نَفَعَ. Also his friend and his close who is part of جَمِيعِ عُلَمَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ الطِّيبُ الْعُقْبِي رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ who said وَإِنَّ دَعْوَتُنَا الْإِصْلَاحِيَّةَ قبل كل شيء وبعده هي دعوة دينية محضة لا دخل لها في السياسة البتة نريد منها تثقيف أمتنا وتهذيب مجتمعنا بتعاليم دين الإسلام الصحيحة ويتخلص في كلمتين ألا نعبد إلا الله وحده وألا تكون عبادتنا له إلا بما شرعه وجاء من عند الله. He says our da'wah before anything else is a pure da'wah of Islam. It has no political agenda in it. لا دخل لها في السياسة البتة. It has no politics in it whatsoever. نريد منها, what we want is تثقيف أمتنا. We want to cultivate our ummah upon مجتمعنا, what? بتعاليم دين الإسلام, based on the knowledge of the religion, which are correct. And then he goes, what religion? وَيَتَّخَلُسُ بِكَلِمَتَيْنِ. It summarizes in two words. أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, that we don't worship anybody other than Allah. وَأَلَّا تَكُونَ عِبَادَتُنَا لَهُ إِلَّا بِمَا شَرْعًا. And that our religion, the legislation is from the Kitab and the Sunnah. The same, my beloved brothers and sisters, Ansar al-Sunnah in Egypt. Al-Shaykh Muhammad Hamid al-Fiqhi, rahimahullah. And al-Shaykh Muhammad Abdul Wahab al-Banna and Abdul Rahman al-Wakil. They did not participate anything in the political movements that were taking place. Taraku hadhihi al-musharakati siyasiya. They left participating in these political. What did they busy themselves with? Washtagalu bil-ilm. They busy themselves with knowledge. They busy ta'aleem, teaching the people. Wa tasheeh al-aqaid, affecting the people's aqeedah and teaching. Wal manahij and the manhaj, correcting all of that. That's what they busy themselves with. So, my beloved brothers and sisters, Dr. Haitham Haddad, all of these ulama who stated what they believed and mentioned it, what is it that they don't know? And what is it that they don't understand that makes Dr. Haitham Haddad hate this notion? This is gharaba, and this is why in the beginning I had to, my beloved brothers and sisters, I had to come out and talk about this point, topic. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to quickly, as time has already finished on my side, I've spoken too long, I'm going to quickly go over some of the mafasid al-mutarattiba ala dukhuli da'wah wa du'ati ila amal siyasi. I'm going to mention some of the harms that it holds. Some of the harms that it holds, the du'at, the people who are meant to give da'wah ila Allahi tabaraka wa ta'ala, participating in these political matters and pushing them into it, the harm that it has. Because the argument that is also always brought, which is what? The reason why we engage in politics is because we are taking the lesser of two evils. We're saving the ummah. The case of the matter, my beloved brothers and sisters, is that there is more mafasid, there's more harm in engaging in these political issues than there is masalih. Or that it's greater evil than it is a lesser of two evils. It's greater evil than it is a lesser of two evils. The first one is, my brothers and sisters, is المفسدة الأولى الاشتغال بالسياسة عن الوظيفة الأساسية. Participating in political issues busies the da'wah and the du'at. It puts the da'wah on hold and it preoccupies the minds of the du'at from that which was important. You see the du'at not seeking knowledge, not learning, not increasing in their understanding of the religion. This is the harms that you see. And that which Shaykh Al-Bani rahimahullah ta'ala summarized, which is at-tasfiyat wa at-tarbiyah, is affected. Which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet for. Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhiran wa da'iyan ila Allahi bi'idhni wa sirajan munira. The Prophet was sent down, wa da'iyan ila Allahi, to call to Allah. He wasn't sent to call to politics. He wasn't sent to call to a group. He was sent down to call the people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, ad-dukhul, والانشغال بالسياسة, going into politics, engaging into it, studying it, putting time in, my beloved brothers and sisters, يصرف الدعاة عن هذه الوظيفة الأساسية. It preoccupies the du'at from this very important thing. The second, and I'm going over it very fast, is the مفسدة that it has is هوان الدعاة في قلوب الناس والمدعوين. The du'at, the people who are calling to the path of Allah, become little in the eyes of the people. Because the people, when they are competing with the people in their dunya, siyasa is worldly issues. The siyasa that we're seeing today, siyasatun wad'iyyah, is worldly issues. And when you see a person with a lihya, a person with a bid, engaging into politics with the general mass, he will drop in the eyes of the people. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, izhad fi dunya yuhibbuka Allah. Be aesthetic from this dunya, Allah will love you. Wazhad fi ma 'inda an-nas, and also be aesthetic from what is in the hands of the people. Be suffice from it. Yuhibbuka an-nas, the people love you. So when the people see you as an individual engaging into politics, you start to place in the people's hearts riba, doubt towards you. And you're placing yourself in what? Mawatin as-su'u dhann, places of speculations and assumptions and bad thoughts. And a believer should stay away from speculation and bad thoughts. Because people are going to start thinking you're in here for the money, somebody's paying you, you're only speaking for this party because they probably pay you and they want you to. And messengers and prophets weren't. We'd stay away from mawatin al-tuham. Safiya bint Huyay radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she came to the Prophet whilst he was doing i'tikaf, and the Prophet was walking her away, there were two companions and they kind of ran fast. The Prophet said to them both, "Ala rislikuma, walk slowly. Inna Safiya bint Tuhiyya." This is my wife Safiya. And then qala subhanallah, they both said subhanallah, meaning, "Ya Rasulullah, we will not think bad of you." And then the Prophet said, "Inna shaytana yajri min al-insani majra ad-dam." Shaytan runs in the person the way the blood runs in the vein. "Wa inni khashitu an yaqdhifa fi qulubikuma su'an aw qala shay'an." I fear that shaytan may throw a bad thought into your hearts. So the du'at will start to become insignificant in the eyes of the people. You see, also the third harm that it has is tanazul ani thawabit wa da'f at-tamassuk bil usul. The person starts to give up the fundamental issues of the religion. They start to become weak. They leave off their foundations. And siyasa is about, it's about da'f al-wala'i wal-bara. Your love and your hate is weakened. You see, you have to start loving everybody in the political group. You have to smile in the mubtadi'i, the dal, the shi'i, the everybody, the mukhannath, the homosexual, everybody you laugh in their face, everything becomes for you what? It becomes la wala wala bara. Everything's wala, there's no bara. You don't free yourself from anybody. And these are waqi' reality that my beloved brothers and sisters, we see. You see, we also see the madhar, التمسك بالسنة في المظهر كاللحية, the beard, it goes, started shortening the beard. You see, the man who was telling, teaching the people yesterday is now shaping up his beard, he's looking different, you see him, احترام الدساتير, respecting the dastur says, you know, the constitution says, the constitution, like the constitution doesn't have المخالفة الشرع, it doesn't oppose the sharia, there are باطل in it, there's كفريات, all of that is not looked at. The fourth thing, which is كثرة التلون والمراوغة وعدم الوضوح والتميز. The person is what? He is not clear. And he's not direct and clear out in the open. ولذلك الشيخ الباني رحمه الله تعالى, in his debates and his discussions, when he would talk to somebody and he asked them a question and the person would say قد. الشيخ الباني would say, "يا رجل قد كلمة السياسيين." The word قد is a word used by politicians. Politicians are not direct people and they're not clear people. They will talk for 45 minutes, they will leave the stage and you don't know what they've just said. Are they for it or are they against it? And this goes against the ayah, Sibghatallahi wa man ahsanu min Allahi sibgha. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he clarified the believers and made them distinct. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala did. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, "Man tashabbaha biqawmin fahuwa minhum." Anyone who imitates a people, he's from them. You're with them, you're like that. ولذلك, the imitation has gone to the extent things that we don't even have control over. My beard becoming white, is it got something to do with me? Allah made it, right? Just so I can't look like the disbelievers, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told me, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us to change our beards, the colors of it. So we do not look like the disbelievers. This is even fi umur, in matters that are not even in our hands. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look what he said, لا يزال الدين ظاهرا معجل الناس الفطور وآخر السحور. Pay attention to this hadith, it's powerful. That the religion will be apparent, strong, as long as what? As long as the people are hastening the iftar and they're delaying the suhoor. By delaying the iftar, by hastening the iftar and delaying the suhoor, the Islam will become apparent. ظاهر, قوة, strength. This is food. Are you with me? So the siyasiyin and the politicians, the issue that they're known for is the issue of al-muraga wal-mutalawun. And the Prophet in the statement which is إِيَّاكَ وَالتَّلَوُّنَ فَإِنَّ دِينَ اللَّهِ وَاحِدٌ. Stay away from being a person of different colours. He's not direct, he's not clear. For verily the religion of Allah is one. Also the fifth harm that it causes, which is what? فَتْحُ الْبَابِ لِلْتَكَسُّ مِنْ خِلَالِ الدَّعْوَةِ. People start making money from this whole issue. You start to make money and the dunya, politics, asking people for money, begging them, دَمُّ الْمَسْأَلَةِ and etc. The sixth thing, which is وَقُوعُ النِّزَاعَاتِ وَالْخِلَافَاتِ بَيْنَ الدُّعَاتِ. You see the du'at always fighting and arguing. What? Based on what? On issues of politics. So-and-so should be elected. No. So-and-so is good for the Muslims. Based on what? Something subjective. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ. كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. The ummah were one. Together. You're breaking the ummah. Why? بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. Transgressing on one another. Based on things that are worldly issues. Also, number seven, which is تُحْمَلُ الدَّعْوَةُ أَخْطَأْ سِيَاسِيِّينَ. Politicians' mistakes, because a da'i is in there, the da'u will suffer because of it. Why would it? Everybody will like, look at the da'wah. And every day the du'at are coming out and they're making bayanat and clarifications and all, this is not our stance, this is not what we meant, this is what... Brothers, wallahi, anyone who was watching what took place in Egypt, the time of Mursi, anyone who was watching it will realize what had took place. The state that what happened to the du'at, how they all scattered, how they got accused of money and this and that. It's just saddening. So my beloved brothers and sisters, this topic, wallahi, is very big. It's large. It requires muhadarat, not one or two. But I hope, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, I have brought the matter to its place. What is it that I give as an advice? And what is the hal? What's the correct solution? This is very important that I conclude with. I'm going to quickly mention it as fast and as quick as I could. My beloved brothers and sisters, is الرجوع إلى الكتاب والسنة بفهم السلف الصالح. Let's go back to the kitab and the sunnah based upon how the pious predecessors understood it. The second, my thing, brothers, is what? Calling the people to what? Calling the people to the three that was just mentioned. Using, in summary, التصفيه والتربيه. Purifying the people and cultivating the people. Purifying them from shirk. Purifying them from bid'ah. Cultivating them upon sunnah and cultivating them upon التوحيد. Are you with me? Also the third thing, which is ترك الدعاة وطلبة العلم والعاملين في مجالات الخير والإغاثة. The du'at and the people of da'wah, busy yourself in da'wah. Leave politics for its people. Leave it for those. Number four, dirasa tajruba al-siyasi allati madat. Study the history that has taken place before. Things that have happened. Like reading the points that I mentioned, Jamaluddin al-Afghani, Muhammad Abdu, Muhammad Rashid Rida, and that which took place in more tafasil. It has to be studied. And it has to be gone through in order to know all of that which is happening. So my beloved brothers and sisters, anything which I had said that was wrong, فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَاللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ بَرِئَانِ مِنْهُ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ